do you believe in the people and do you believe in their ability to grow, right? Yeah. It's also not just about people that have already made it, but it's also simply seeing the potential and believing in the people to grow and developing further.
Welcome to the Growth Show. What keeps us driving is what drives you further. This is your hosts, Sebastian Kunz
and Sarah Kaya.
Hello everyone and welcome to this week's episode of The Growth Show. We have the big pleasure to be here today with Matthias Ockenfels. Matthias is the founder and CEO of MOI Ventures. He also joined Point Nine Capital back in July 2013 as a principal. After that, he joined UniPlaces as a general manager to then join his final destination as of now as a partner at Speed Invest. Matthias, thank you so much for being in the show with us.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for having me and great to be here.
So, Matthias, just to kick off our podcast, our famous question we always ask is, if you connect the dots, growth and yourself, how would you describe it?
Yeah, that's a very good question. And I think growth is actually a very fundamental point in my own development over the years, basically, since I started studying, basically. If I think about what has been, so to say, the red line, so to say, throughout my own professional development, actually, I think growth has always been that, always striving to kind of make the next step, growing yourself, learning, also growing into roles that you maybe didn't think in the first place you would be able to fill when you started out. So I think from that, from a very general point of view, from a very holistic point of view, I think growth has always been an important part of myself and of my own development. If I think about it today from my current position, so to say, as a partner in a venture capital fund, as an investor at Speed Invest, we obviously help companies and founders to grow and to realize their full potential. So in a way, I see myself as an enabler of growth for others. Mm-hmm. So we are working very closely with founding teams to help them grow. But we are also growing ourselves while we do it, because we learn from everyone that we work with, right? We're also not stopping, and we're also trying to grow ourselves. We also try to grow the level of ambition of founders and help them to develop their vision, develop themselves as founders. And lastly, I myself obviously also want to grow, and I also use this as a big playground, basically, and to try out things and to learn and to grow myself.
Very, very cool. You already mentioned this now at Speed Invest, but this entire career already started 11 years ago in 2008. How did this start? Was this something you planned before, or did you just slide into this role, or how did this career start?
No, it's very unconventional, I would say. So it's really... I also always have to think about it, how many coincidences basically are involved with this, to me getting into this field. So it's actually good to start in 2008 or even a little bit earlier when I started studying, because I went to a business school in Germany studying general business and finance. And even already starting at that specific business school was a bit of a coincidence, or because I actually wasn't accepted in the first place, but I only got in through someone else dropping out after already being accepted and then me taking the space of that person. and actually, I'm mentioning that because when I studied there, you get to know obviously a lot of alumni of the school, and one of the alumni got in touch with me towards the end of my studies to ask whether I was looking for an internship, and he was explaining me what kind of internship they were offering. And as part of the studies, you had to do an internship. And I actually only understood a little bit of what he was saying, and was mostly Chinese to me, to be honest, and sounded, I didn't really get it. I got that it had something to do with finance, with founders, with the internet and technology. So all things that I had been involved with and that I liked, that I was interested in, but I didn't really make this whole connection with venture capital because I didn't know about it really. And also with this whole entrepreneurial and entrepreneurship ecosystem. Also in Europe at the time, it was still very early and didn't really exist. So I started working there without really knowing what I was signing up for as an intern. And then realized that this whole universe of tech startups, of entrepreneurship, of venture capital, startup financing existed and totally fell in love with it. And then also continued to work for the same firm after graduating from business school. And that's basically how I made my first baby steps, so to say, into investment in 2008 and then in 2009. And it really came all from an internship, so to say, that I started without even knowing what I was signing up for.
So that's a great story, Matthias. And I mean, in your daily life as an investor, as a partner, we can only imagine that you see a lot of exciting pitches, a lot of exciting executive summaries. How many of these do you usually see per year or per month even? And which one of these, I don't know, 10, 100, 1,000, sticked in your mind and you still remember today and was the best that you could say you've ever seen and why?
Yeah, wow, that's a tough one because you see so many. So just to give you an idea, at Speed Invest overall, and we have multiple teams, we probably see between 5,000 to 6,000 pitches per year. So that's really at the top of the funnel, so to say. So that's everyone that is getting in touch with us that has an idea which could somehow be a fit maybe, right? There's also many that are not a fit after having a first look, but let's say all the ones that are really not fitting, that are in a completely different sector, I already exclude from that. But let's say we see between 5,000 to 6,000. Just in the fund that I'm taking care of, Speed Invest X, we probably, because of the focus that we have, we only focus on marketplaces, platforms. We probably see around 1,500 just in that vertical. So that's, and we eventually invest into maybe 8 to 10 companies per year from those 1,500. You have to have a really narrow filter, really, to get to those 8 to 10 companies. If I think about the companies that really stood out, it's funny because if I think about the most successful ones in terms of also growth, financial success, and so on, it's probably the ones that didn't even have a pitch. So one of the first companies that I ever backed in my whole career, actually when I started out in 2009, was Lieferando, which is a big German food delivery platform that then was acquired by Takeaway, which then IPO'd. And I think when I invested into that company and was talked to them, they didn't even have a pitch. They didn't even have an investment deck. I just came across them because they were sitting in the same office with another portfolio company of ours. And I was asking them, hey, what are you doing here? Let me have a look. Oh, it looks interesting. Let's talk. So there was no real pitch in that sense. Then another company that is a bit younger one, but already also fairly successful. And I think you also had one of the founders here on the podcast a couple of episodes before, Tier Mobility, for example. Yeah. We also invested when there was no pitch, because there were basically the founders that actually some of them we connected to each other. Because I knew them all from a long time ago already, and they then decided to do this, and we said, okay, if you're doing this, I want to be part of it. I want to be in. Let's do it. And also, there was no pitch, as in there is a pitch deck, and it's all polished already, and so on. It was all very 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 early, and I just knew that these are great people, and I want to be a part of it. Of whatever they are doing, basically.
Mm-hmm. It's funny that you mentioned this, that you brought these people together, because I think one of the co-founders of Tier was one of the co-founders of Lieferando, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you actually connected these founders to then build one of the most successful startups in Europe.
Yeah, well, let's say so far very successful. Obviously, it always takes time. I'm also in this long enough to know that things take time, and it's usually a marathon, not a sprint, right? But let's say it's doing very, very well, of course. And yes, exactly. I actually knew Lawrence, who's the CEO and one of the co-founders since his first startup, Rebuy, where I was also involved with one of my first in one of my first jobs. Then I know Matthias, who is the CTO, who was actually also the CTO of Lieferando and of Takeaway. And then Julian, obviously, I also know, who was previously at Coop, and we also have been friends for quite some time. Mm-hmm. So yes, at one point in my previous career, I have been in contact and got to know all these people separately from each other, basically. And then that's, it's just a very nice also coincidence. And then, I don't know, years later, all of this comes together in this way and pays off. But I mean, I would never have known, right? So that's, you can't plan for this.
That sounds actually totally like great network effects, which leads me actually to my next question. When people look you up, they might read more than once that you personally love network effects. So What was by far the most remarkable network effect you've seen so far, and why?
Yeah, so I think for me, why I came to this conclusion, or why I say I love network effects, and why we are also focusing on this specific topic with Speedinvest X, is basically actually Lieferando, to be honest. I think when I was in my first job working as an investment manager or analyst at a VC firm 10 years ago or over 10 years ago, I was looking a lot of business models in Europe that were picking up. And I came to the conclusion for myself that basically I like what I called at the time transaction-based business models. So I didn't even have that notion of network effects back then. But I just realized that I really like it if you're somehow in the middle, you're the middleman, you're facilitating a transaction and you can take a cut of it without actually having to do a lot of the heavy lifting, so to say. And I just like the idea of it from a investor point of view, but also as being kind of in between things, being the facilitator. And that was just an initial idea. I wasn't really familiar that much with the whole notion of network effects and all that, but more like really experienced it from a practical side. And then when we invested in Lieferando at the time, I could really see how the network effects were unfolding and how the company was growing exponentially when they were onboarding more and more restaurants onto the platform, and how it was spreading and people were getting also their friends onto it through word of mouth and so on, and how that whole thing was exploding. And that was really interesting to see, and see how this also not just works in theory, but then also in practice. And then I really said, okay, that's what I like. I only want to invest into this. I only want to focus on this going forward. And I think since then, I've kind of been refining my own view on this, my own approach to it, and my own strategy to it. But to answer the second part of your question also on what are the strongest network effects that I have seen, and maybe I'm not going to mention a specific type of network effect, but just also another story of how I experienced it. In one of my other previous jobs, I worked for Naspers. It's a big multinational media company that actually owns a lot of marketplaces around the world. And I worked for one of their subsidiaries at the time in Switzerland, which is called Ricardo. And Ricardo is actually the largest horizontal marketplace of Switzerland, like the eBay of Switzerland, basically, right? And what I could see there is this company that was already, I don't know, 8, 9 years or even 10 years old at the time when I worked there, had tremendous network effects, and basically had, I think, over 90% unsustained brand awareness in the Swiss market. So everyone in Switzerland knew about them. When you would ask them, where do you buy used goods online, they would immediately say Ricardo, right? They wouldn't even ask, like, unsustained brand awareness of 80-90%, something along those lines, right? And I think there was something where you see when network effects have really kicked in and people keep on coming back and back and find what they like and everyone goes there, this is when it really works. And we had an amazing profit margin and amazing growth still, even though we were already at 90% market penetration, so to say. And this is really when, and to be honest, the product wasn't perfect. It was a little bit stalling and it looked a little bit old-fashioned, just as, Craigslist in the US. You wouldn't probably call them out for having a particularly great product or anything like that, but they nobody would care because you knew if you go there, you simply find what you're looking for and you get it at the price that you want. So they had all the liquidity on the marketplace. Mm-hmm. And I think this is just the best manifestation, so to say, of network effects in real life. And when you experience that, you see how strong it is. So they forgive you a lot of mistakes, let me put it this way, or on the product side, or you can even have, and excuse my language here, a really shitty product or stop innovating on product and network effects will still carry on, right? Mm-hmm. I don't want to encourage anyone to not continue to innovate on product and build product. Mm. But having very strong network effects is definitely creates such a high defensibility that you do not that it will forgive you a lot of product mistakes, so to say, right?
That's totally right. I think probably my next question will also be part of the network effects. But first of all, with Speedinvest, you also invest, like, in which stage do you start to invest in different kind of, like, vertical startups? Sure. you invest in?
Sure. So, I mean, we invest very early. We're usually one of the first investors or institutional investors coming in. So we invest between 100,000 euros to 1 million euros as a first ticket, a first check, mm-hmm. What you would typically also refer to as a pre-seed or a seed stage. Mm-hmm. So when the company, let's say, has already a product, maybe some first customers, has built an MVP, a minimum viable product, and attracted some first customers, but it's not really scalable yet, but you can see that there is some demand and people like what you've built, or you have some first customers. This is usually when we come in and when we help to solidify that, when we help to grow that and basically make the next step and start maybe scaling, or make the first step in scaling the business and try to develop a more scalable sales channel or more scalable marketing channels with our money to grow the business. Mm-hmm. So usually there's maybe a founding team, maybe some first employees, but usually the company is not bigger than between 10 to 20 people. Mm-hmm. Sometimes even just the founders, as I mentioned for Tier, for example, right? Mm-hmm. And it's still fairly early. But it also depends. I don't think that the example that I gave earlier of Tier is the best example for what we usually do, because typically the company is already a bit more advanced. But when you are working with people that you obviously know for a long time that have been also successful as founders previously, it makes it also easier to take a bit more risk earlier on and come in when there's less proof points, because you know that these people can do it and will make it happen and are able to deliver.
Mm-hmm. That sounds that most of the startups at least have already solved the typical chicken egg problem, right?
So I would say for a platform or marketplace, they haven't really solved it in a sense that it's scaling on both sides, but they have shown that there is a way to crack it.
Yeah.
So that they have already maybe done some matchmaking and so basically, and you can see that this could be working, but they haven't solved it in a scalable way. But it does not necessarily, right? If it's a pre-seed investment and we are really just investing into a great team that is set out to build something, it's still fairly early, and they probably even haven't done any transactions yet. So both is possible.
Yeah.
But it probably also depends on the team itself, right? Someone that already is experienced, has done it before, higher chances we come in earlier, pre-launch. Someone maybe with a little bit less experience, probably rather post-launch, right? To maybe give a little bit of a framework for this.
So besides the business, of course, the team is also important, right?
Team is extremely important, no matter what, because at such an early stage, when you have very little signals from the business, it's all about the team. And I'm sometimes joking that for the job that we are doing, and given the stage at which we are investing, it would probably be better to have a psychology degree and be a psychologist and be really good at judging people rather than at judging businesses, so to say, right? It's also a lot, and this is what I also like here with regards to the topic of the podcast and your topic. It's also a lot about, do you believe in the people and do you believe in their ability to grow, right? Yeah. It's also not just about people that have already made it, but it's also simply seeing the potential and believing in the people to grow and developing further.
Absolutely. So speaking of the chicken egg problem, what is, in your point of view, the most clever way to solve that typical chicken egg problem? What did you have seen so far which really impressed you, where you did think like, wow?
What I've seen, I think I can't say, it's different ways for different companies and a different market. So I don't think there is kind of the one way to do it. There's no silver bullet. I think what I've seen a couple of times and what I usually find impressive is you can obviously also fake one side of the marketplace. and maybe faking it sounds too negative. But it just means that if you figure out which one is the harder side to crack, so to say, is it demand or supply side in case of a two-sided marketplace, then you probably try to maybe kind of fake the side that is harder, do some first transactions, and then try to also crack that side of the marketplace. Mm-hmm. When you have maybe, let's say it's the supply side, you need demand, you do a few transactions, where you are basically on one side of the marketplace yourself, then when you have done so and you have the demand and people start or customers start trusting you, then you also try to onboard more on the supply side. You've also better understood how it works, so it hopefully makes it also easier for you to onboard the supply. Mm-hmm. Right? So that's one tactic that I have seen quite a few times. And then it's actually many, many times it's very unscalable things where you're literally taking the phone and you're just calling up people and running after them. And it's a very kind of intensive sales, but it's something that I think is worth in order to get the flywheel going and solve this initial chicken egg problem. Because once you've done that, then it should kick in automatically itself, right? I think it's totally fine to do these kind of unscalable things in the beginning, if it serves in order to develop very scalable ways of doing it.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned, Matthias, that you hear around 1,500 pitches, and then out of these 1,500, you end up investing in 8 to 10. What actually makes you invest in a marketplace? What helps you identify a great platform, a great marketplace for you to invest in?
Yeah, so I mean, we don't... I think at the very early stage that we invest, we barely see any network effects in the numbers or in the business. What we see is the potential to develop network effects in the beginning or throughout the development of the company, I mean. But we need to see that potential for network effects to kick in and to develop. Yeah. And then in order for us to be excited about it. So that is basically a first... a criteria, so to say, generally speaking. They don't have to be there. They will never be there at the time when we invest because it's simply too early. Yeah. And the company is still, and the business is usually still too small, but we need to see the potential for them to develop over time. So that's one. I think then the other one is a lot around the team, as I mentioned already, right? I mean, let me put it this way. A bad team will even screw up a really good idea. A really good team, even if they start out with a bad idea, so to say, they will always pivot and manage the way to build a great business. So a lot is about the team. And then for the team, it's mostly about, is it a complementary skill set? Do people have prior experience that comes in handy for building this kind of business? Do they bring, are they actually able to grow, right? Are they willing to learn? Are they very curious? Are they fast learners? Can they adjust, move fast? A lot is simply about being very fast in making mistakes, then correcting them and moving on and always iterating. Yeah. So I think that is a very important ability of any founder, not just a marketplace or platform business. And then there's a few criteria that I think apply primarily to, let's say, VC funded companies, where VCs obviously look for a certain outcome. Usually any early stage VC aims to invest into companies that can be so-called fund makers. What does that mean? That means that at the time of a potential exit, so I don't know, 8 to 10 years down the line, the stake of the VC in the company is worth one time the fund. So that's why it's also important for a founder, whenever you talk to a VC, to understand how big is the fund, how much ownership do they usually take, and what does that mean for myself? Mm. That's why it's different to take, I don't know, a lot of money from a very big fund, right? Because it puts much more pressure on the company to build a really, really big business to be able to deliver these kind of returns to the fund in terms of returning one time the fund versus speaking to a smaller fund, maybe. So usually I would say that the alignment between a smaller fund and the founders themselves is usually higher. Because for us to return a 50 million euro fund is so to say much easier. It's still hard enough, trust me, but it's easier than returning a 500 million fund, right? And it also it also creates a different type of companies that we are looking for, right? It does not mean that we are looking for small outcomes, but we are also happy if a company sells for 200 or 300 million. No, because if we still own 5 or 10% in this company at the time of the exit, it is a fund maker for us, yeah. Right? Mm-hmm. If for anyone that runs a 500 million euro fund, I'm not sure if that will work out. Mm-hmm. At the same time, if the company becomes way bigger than that, we are also happy, right? We are not against that. We are super happy. And we will not tell anyone to sell when the company gets to, I don't know, 200, 300, 400 million valuation. It's not what we do. But my point is just that in case you do not become bigger, it's also not a big deal for us, so to say.
Yeah.
But it might be for a larger fund. And so that is very important to consider when any founder speaks to a fund, I think, and also to consider this about VC in general. I have a talk that I give to founders, which is about the dynamics and the VC business model, basically. And usually I started with the sentence, at the end of this talk, I want that 90% of you do not want to raise VC money. Because it's not for everyone. It's not made for every business, which does not mean that if you are not attractive to a VC, it does not mean that your business is not attractive at all. This is what a lot of people mistake. They think, If a VC doesn't want to invest, this is like kind of a bad signal in general. No, it just means you are not a VC type of case. But it can still be a very good business. It can still be a very sustainable business, right? It's just not a case that works from a VC perspective.
Even though sometimes it could be also the timing, right?
Well, you have to, kiss many frogs, right? So, I mean, that is just the general rule of thumb of fundraising.
Regardless
in which business you are, so to say, right? The more people you talk to, the higher the chances you meet someone that is interested and will invest. So I think that holds true for anything. It's just a rule of big numbers, basically. But regardless, I think there are obviously different VC for different stages. So in terms of timing, and maybe companies already, so to say, too late for us. Right, but still early enough for another VC who usually comes in at a later stage, who also invests a bigger ticket, right? But then has also to believe that the company has a bigger outcome, right? And you can raise money from different VCs over the lifetime of the company. And that's also how we see it. We are very much specified on the and focused on the early stages, on pre-seed, seed, maybe early Series A. Mm. But then there's other funds that are focused on a Series A, Series B, Series C. And we are very happy to stay in the company and we are in for the long ride. But they will take over, they will invest once the company has become bigger, once the outlook is a little bit clearer, so to say, and you can say with more confidence that the company will go in a certain direction and has the potential to become so large. And then they take over, they invest more, but we are very happy to stay on board, of course, right? It doesn't mean that we are getting out, but ideally we come in before and then we just stay in until maybe in 8, 9, 10 years, there is an exit, I don't know, an IPO, company gets acquired, etc.
Yeah, I mean, I totally agree with you. Sometimes it's timing, sometimes it's the right person on the other side of the table and stuff like that. So
timing is super important in any case. It's also when do you start your business, right? That's also another element of timing is we are seeing similar models or ideas over and over again, but at different times, right? If I still remember a couple of years ago, everyone was talking about mobile payment and saying, this year it's coming. And then another year, and this year's coming, it's not coming. And then eventually it comes, right? But if you timed it wrongly and you started 3 years too early, you might never have hit that kind of growth curve at the right time. And if you then do not have enough money to basically stay around until it finally takes off, you might have been simply too early. And many, many times it's just about timing when you start and is it the right time right now?
And sometimes it's just that you just be persistent. For example, one of the earlier episodes, we had the co-founder of Eat Clever on board here in our podcast. And he told us that in the beginning, it was very hard to explain why people would order healthy food online, and nowadays it's just totally clear why people would like to Google for healthy food and why would they would order it online by a delivery service. So I mean, sometimes it's like that you should just be persistent and wait for the right time.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, from that point of view, I still remember with Lieferando, it was all about the pitch at the early days was basically, okay, people are switching from phone to ordering food online, and everyone was like, why should I do it? It's super convenient with the phone, right? Yeah. And I mean, today you wouldn't even ask that question anymore.
That's true.
So again, like timing, but then it was just about the right time to make that switch for different factors, right? The proliferation of smartphones, the internet becoming faster, basically enabling all this. If you would have done it 5 years before, probably wouldn't have taken off to the same degree. So I think it's that's always the question.
So since we talked already a lot about marketplaces, people who are listening right now can like join a conference about marketplaces on 19th November with a discount code called GS15. They get a 15% discount. Since it's also your conference, you might maybe share a few words about that conference.
Absolutely, no, and yeah, very happy to explain a little bit more. So basically, when we launched the fund 2 years ago, the X fund, we also thought it would be great to set up an event series for marketplace founders and marketplace investors to basically exchange know-how, exchange best practices, learn from each other, and grow eventually. So. And we set up this event, which we do twice a year between Berlin and San Francisco. It's 500 people, one full day, over 30 sessions with over 30 speakers on three stages, all of which are actually C-level in well-known and popular platform businesses or marketplace businesses. So we have, for example, Get Your Guide there. We have people from even WeWork, previous WeWork people there. That will be very interesting. Mm-hmm. We have people from Sender, We have people, we have also investors there that frequently invest in marketplaces like Excel, SoftBank, and so on. So I think it will be very, very interesting. It's going to be on November 19th in Berlin. And for all listeners and subscribers to this podcast, there's a little discount, GS15 on marketplaceconf.com. You get a 15% off. Very much looking forward to it. This has been just growing over the years. We basically did it because we wanted to give an ability to also our portfolio companies to exchange with other experts, learn from each other. We also made it open because we thought it would be nice to get other people on board. And it was also a little bit out of constraints, to be honest. And maybe also, again, one topic for this podcast, I think you usually always grow when you get to your limits. And we had financial limits at the time. So we simply said, okay, if we do it a closed event and we have to finance it all ourselves, it will be tough. We don't have that money. So let's make it open. We take a little entrance fee, but have some sponsors. But this way, we can actually make it bigger, and we can do it the way we wanted to do it, and we have the budget to do it. Mm-hmm. And that's how it all started. And yeah, check it out on marketplaceconf.com.
It sounds like a great conference for marketplace founders and those who are interested in it. What are marketplaces you like to use yourself?
Well, it's an easy one. I'm obviously using Tier a lot here in Berlin. But I'm also using a lot of the on-demand delivery marketplaces for food or ordering groceries, mm-hmm. Or ordering dinner, these kind of things. I'm a very, in that sense, very convenient person. So that helps very well from a consumer point of view. I'm also, to be honest, a big fan of Amazon. Same for also convenience reasons. And I think they're just, they're always upping the bar in the game and making sure that everyone keeps on innovating, so to say. So, yeah. I mean, I would be lying otherwise. So I'm a big fan. I'm using it a lot. I also know that it's not uncontroversial because they also have a lot of people working in their warehouses and so on. But in terms of from a purely consumer point of view, convenience point of view, I like that. I like that a lot. And I also realized that more and more companies, like even Zalando, that started out as pure e-commerce players, are now moving more and more into marketplaces and trying to be a platform and offering their own platform and opening it up to others to become a marketplace, basically. Mm-hmm. So the lines are getting a little bit more blurry in that sense.
Yeah. To be honest, I'm also like using a lot Amazon, but also because of the convenient reasons you mentioned.
Yeah.
How would you describe the process of identifying platforms you like to invest in?
Well, we take a lot of the criteria that we mentioned earlier, but then you also have to think about obviously what is coming up in the next 5 to 10 years. What are the big trends that we are observing or that will come up? So it's a little bit like looking into the crystal ball and thinking about how will people and businesses behave in 5 to 10 years from now. And it's also what I like a lot about the job. It doesn't make it easy. But to give you an example, for one of the companies that we backed, for example, it's called AdMix. And they are developing basically an ad network, so to say, for AR, VR environments. So they allow anyone to place ads programmatically in immersive environments. And obviously, if you invest in such a company, you must believe that AR, VR will take off in the near future and that it will be widespread and a lot of people will be in immersive environments, will use AR, VR in one or the other way. And because they are essentially building the picks and shovels for this business to advertise in such environments. And that's what I like about it. To be very frank, it's very hard for me to predict if AR, VR will take off in the next 5 to 10 years. But if I believe that it will, then this will be massive, right? Yeah. Because that's the basis for anything in advertising, technology, in such a scenario. So what you do as a VC is you look into a lot of these kind of binary outcomes where you say, if this works, it has to be big. Also for the dynamics that I mentioned earlier. Mm-hmm. And that's what we are basically also looking for. That's a little bit of our filter, right? We're not necessarily looking for incremental improvements or smaller steps. What we are looking for is it's really the paradigm shifts, the kind of binary outcomes. And that's usually what a VC likes, mm-hmm. not just us, but I think anyone. And that's also what we like about marketplaces and platforms. So I think in for example, B2C, a lot of the things have been done already, so to say, right? There is, big marketplaces for jobs, for real estate, for cars or for mobility, goods or products. There are these marketplaces. But then think about how can technology fundamentally change the experience of these marketplaces and you build a better one. So for example, one of the marketplaces that we backed with Speed Invest was a company called Spock. You maybe still remember. It's basically a Craigslist, but all on mobile. Mm. And they basically completely nailed it in a couple of markets like Austria, but also the UK and for some time also in Germany by basically building a better version of Craigslist or eBay classifieds, purely focused on mobile. And they could do this because suddenly mobile took off, everyone had a smartphone, and mobile internet took off, right? And that's what I'm looking for. So what does it mean if everyone suddenly has a smartphone in their pocket? What does that mean for marketplaces that I'm building? So for example, we invested into one marketplace that is doing exactly this, but for jobs, where you are not having a CV anymore, but you're recording a video of yourself, and then you can apply to jobs with that very easily, right? So all these things, what kind of technologies enable a completely new customer experience, and then therefore I can build a better marketplace or platform than the ones are already there today in B2C. Mm-hmm. I think in B2B, it's much more greenfield still. It's like blue ocean. There's actually not that many marketplaces right now, so it's still the first wave. So it's just like building a marketplace at all, digitizing the inventory, digitizing supply. And usually that is more SaaS-enabled marketplaces where you maybe build a SaaS platform to hook in with the supply or demand side, bring that online, and then build a marketplace on top of that. So I think that's what we are looking for a bit more in B2B. Or I think that's the dynamics that we observe in B2B. And in B2C, it's a bit more like kind of the next generation of marketplaces.
Mm-hmm. So in your experience, Matthias, you've heard so many pitches, you've been approached by so many founders and people. What would be the best way, like for any entrepreneur out there that wants to have an investment, an early stage investment by Speedinvest X, for example? Yeah. What's the best possible way to approach you? And what would be the worst possible way to approach you?
So I think in general, we are fairly open. I mean, there's our email address on the website. There is a contact form. You can ping me on Twitter or LinkedIn and whatnot. Usually what is helpful is obviously you get a referral from a befriended entrepreneur or investor, because that is helpful for us to also serve as some sort of filter where we have to go through all of these requests. We are aiming to answer everyone and answer everyone on time, no matter if they are approaching us cold, so to say, or if it was a warm introduction. Mm-hmm. But obviously, a warm introduction is a certain indication, right? but again, we are like open on all channels. And actually, some people always think it's better to send a cold email. I actually don't mind if people even submit through our contact form on the website, because it's immediately in our systems and we can we have a process behind that, and then it gets treated in the right way. It's actually more convenient for us in that sense. And there's the chances are probably higher you get a quick answer, which I think at the end of the day, every founder is primarily interested in knowing where they stand and if it's interesting or not. And you want to get a quick answer so you know if it's worth spending more time on this or not. on both sides. And that's what we also try to do and what we try to provide. And that's why we're trying to be very open on all channels. I think what is always helpful if you want to increase the chances is to basically share a short pitch deck that quickly explains your business, or maybe a short video or anything that makes it easy for us to grasp what you are trying to do, what you want to do. I think nobody has to be afraid of, I don't know, us stealing ideas or that, because if there's one thing that I learned about the last 10 or 11 years being in this business, it's not about ideas. It's about execution and actually giving birth to these ideas and making them reality. Mm-hmm. Everyone has a lot of ideas every day, but actually pursuing them, making the reality, executing on them is the really hard part. So don't be afraid of anyone taking away your idea, but rather try to get the money to make it a reality. So I think that's very important.
It's a very, very good sentence, a good last sentence from your side, Matthias. It was a very inspiring conversation with too many good things that you said to really wrap this up accordingly. But I tried to mention a few highlights that you mentioned throughout the conversation. Funny is that you mentioned in the beginning that the position that you have right now was a lot of coincidences that happened, a lot of factors that you didn't control played with each other for you to end up in the position that you are right now. And you were always thriving to grow into new roles, always thriving to tackle new challenges. And not only this, but also to enable growth of other people and companies.
Exactly.
And you talked about your enthusiasm and your passion about network effects. And you said when you have a strong network effect, this creates a high defensibility and a very, very stable position in the market. And of course, we hear this a lot. It's not about the idea primarily, it's about the team. So you mentioned a really, really good team will manage a way to create a successful business. And on the other side, a bad team always finds a way to fuck up a great idea.
Exactly.
So yeah, and also what you said is you usually grow when you get to your limits. And I think this is very interesting to push yourself, to push the limits and boundaries to really grow into a better and more successful person. And it's not about the ideas, it's about the execution, because we all have great ideas. Everyone wakes up with a $1 billion idea, but nobody executes upon it. So I think this was a very, very good last sentence from you, Matthias. And it was a big pleasure hearing your insights, your experiences. And thank you so, so much for being on the show with us.
Well, it was great being here. Thanks for having me, and always a pleasure.